Hi guys, welcome back to my channel, and if you're new, welcome to my channel. My name is Stephanie Yates, Anya Bwile, Steph Anya for short, and I'm a licensed associate marriage and family therapist. This channel is for fellow therapists, those who are thinking of becoming therapists, and those who are using therapy insight to create their best life. And today's video is another one for that second group, those who are considering becoming therapists. Today, we're going to be talking about how to choose the perfect program for you. If you're curious, stay tuned. What's on your mind? This video was inspired by one of my consultations. I had a consultation recently that was definitely very geared towards trying to select the best grad school for them, and some great things came up in the conversation that I thought would be useful to share with the whole audience. So let's talk about the things to consider. The first thing I would say is to choose off the bat, are you interested in online or are you strictly looking for a brick and mortar program? Brick and mortar means a traditional setting. This will help to eliminate some of the schools, and if you're open to both, then you just can still continue to move down the list and see what meets your needs. When you're deciding between online and brick and mortar, things to factor in are you working a full-time job? Do you have kids? Are you able to not work and go to a campus? Do they have night classes where you could go to work and then come and do night classes? Or do they treat it like an undergrad program, right? Where you are going throughout the day, basically school is your job at that point, right? Those are some of the things that you want to consider. The next thing to consider, especially if you're looking for a more traditional campus brick and mortar setting, is the in-state tuition versus out-of-state tuition, okay? So if you are in Georgia, for example, but you're thinking you might want to go to a school in Texas, well, in Texas, you're gonna have to pay out-of-state tuition fees. So you want to consider that when you're making your decision. It's totally okay if you plan to land in Texas, right, to go ahead and get your degree in Georgia, and then you can apply for licensure in Texas. So this brings me to my next point. If you are planning to move to a different state and maybe possibly practice in a different state, you want to compare the requirements for that graduate program with the requirements for that state, okay? Because licensure portability, especially for marriage and family therapists, is not the best. Really, for most mental health professions, they're not the best. You know, you have a lot of situations where you're going through the ringer with state boards trying to prove that you are qualified to practice in their state. And so the best thing you can do is look up the requirements for that state you want to go to as far as sitting for their associate exam or licensing exam. What are their requirements for a graduate student to be able to apply? And so you want to look for things like, how many hours do you need to get during practicum? Are there specific classes that need to be included in the curriculum? Some states are that specific. You need to look at the breakout of relational hours versus direct client hours. Relational hours means that you have more than one person who's the client, so maybe a couple or a family, maybe a pair of friends, and see if the school or program that you're considering aligns with the state you plan to move to. I could have sat for my exam in Georgia only having 500 hours with only one person as my client. My program required that I have two or more for half of my hours. So that slowed me down a little bit. So those are things to consider when you're looking at a program. You want to make sure that your state and your school are as in alignment as possible. You also want to look at how many credit hours and classes are required for graduating. Because if you're evaluating based on tuition costs and it seems like, oh, this is less per class, however, it actually looks as though there are gonna be significantly more classes, then that could actually work against you if you're trying to monitor the cost of the entire program. Okay, another thing to consider is how semester scheduling works, right? So you want to know, a lot of programs are going to have a cohort model where you're essentially with the same group of people. I know some programs are as selective as they only allow 6 people into a cohort, so it can be quite competitive. There are other programs that don't even utilize the cohort model. My program does not utilize a cohort model. I can start school any given Monday. I went to North Central University and have several videos on that if you're interested in that school. But I didn't have to worry about, you know, starting class in the fall or the spring to start with my cohort. I was able to start classes anytime I wanted to. So you want to look at the format for classes. And the reason this becomes really important is, you know, for a school like mine, let's say if I started running low on funds and I really couldn't take, you know, I needed to take a break from classes, I was able to do that. If you're in a cohort model, you might have to wait all the way until the next year so that you are doing the same things that the other people are doing within a cohort. So if you need a really flexible model where, you know that your funds may be limited or your time may be changing, you might want to program this a little bit more flexible, because with a cohort model, you really have to stick with that group of people or be with a group of people, and you all are learning the same thing at the same time. The next thing that you want to consider is how they go about doing internships. All right, so for a traditional brick and mortar setting, I would say try to find a program where their internships are offered through the program, like there's a clinic on site, right? Because otherwise you're in a campus environment, but trying to work with going to class and figuring out when you can get to your internship site. So most brick and mortar programs do come with their own clinic that you can practice out of. And it's good to also find out, is there a thriving flow of clients coming in and out of that clinic? Because they might have a clinic, but not really have a process for garnering more clients. So you have a place to practice, but no clients to practice with. So that's a really good thing. Maybe talk with other students there and see what was their experience like as far as being able to have enough clients to meet their graduate requirements. In an online format, you might actually have to find your internship, right? So if you're in a small town and you have to find your internship, that can be a really large project that turns into a second job for you. So you want to really consider whether or not finding your own internship is something that you can manage. Some of us get really lucky and find a place the first time, but then I know also the horror stories of people who were looking for an internship for a year, okay? So you want to make sure that if you're in a small town, you know where you intend to do your internship and look at the requirements for your program for your supervisor as well, to make sure that there is a supervisor at the place that you'd like to intern that can meet the requirements that you need, or if they allow you to do a supervisor from somewhere else. The most important thing to consider is accreditation. Now, there are a lot of programs. Some aren't accredited at all. Some are regionally accredited and some are COAMFD accredited. COAMFD accreditation is the golden standard for marriage and family therapists. This will give you your best shot at really passing any exam, whether it's a state mandated exam, especially let's say if you're going from one state to another to take your exam, then you want to make sure you have that COAMFD accreditation. If it is a regionally accredited program and they just use a state licensing exam, you might be able to just utilize that, especially if the tuition costs are more within your wheelhouse. But I would really encourage you to find a COAMFD accredited program. There are a few online COAMFD accredited programs. I attended one of them, and significantly more COAMFD accredited brick and mortar programs. I'll actually put a link in the description box where you can find all COAMFD accredited programs, and that way you can get a better sense of what's available in your state. I hope that this video helped. If you have any other things that you utilize while selecting your graduate program, please put those in the comments below. I appreciate you for watching this video. I ask that you like this video, subscribe to my channel, click the bell notification so that you know every time I upload, and also share it with a friend so that they can find the channel and let me know what videos would be useful for them. Again, my name is Stephanie Yates Anyabwile, Steph Anya for short. I appreciate you for watching all the way until the end of the video. That really, really helps me. Thank you.